Hi, I'm Todd Jones. I host the podcast Press Box Access.
Check out this clip from my conversation with Charles Pierce. Pierce tells us what it was like to cover the NBA during a unique period of time when Magic, Bird, a young Jordan, and the Bad Boy Pistons ruled.
Well, he obviously grew as a person, and you witnessed that. You also witnessed the growth of pro basketball itself because of him and Magic, and Jordan comes in after them. As a writer, a journalist, in that era, access was different. You talked about that when you talked about the Big East. What was it like covering the NBA?
Well, I was very lucky, in a sense, in that every spring, my job at the Herald, before I started writing columns, was to write sidebars from the visitors' locker room. So not only did, you know, I get to know the Celtics because we were traveling with them, really, but I got to know the Hawks of that era, the Dominique Wilkins Hawks, obviously the Lakers of that era, the Bucks of that era with Sidney Moncrief, the Rockets when, you know, Olajuwon and Ralph Sampson were there, and the Pistons, right in the late 80s with, you know, my favorite human being, one of my favorite human beings of all time, Vinnie Johnson. And,
Wait a minute. Why do you say Vinny? That?
Vinny was the most basic human being I ever met. Vinny. First of all, I loved the way he played. You know, you get off the bench firing, and you put the ball in the air, and you don't stop till you come out of the game. And second of all, I loved his physique. He was a giant chest and stuff, and he always looked to me. Shelby Strother was the first one to make this comparison. He always said Vinny looked like he should be like an African diplomat. He should have had one of those, you know, whatever those things, a fly with or whatever, you know, representing Liberia at the UN. But I used to love to talk to Vinny. And of course, this was also the Pistons, not only of Isaiah Thomas, but of John Sally and of the incredibly reclusive Dennis Rodman when he was a youngster. So, I got to know the other teams pretty well. John Sally used to, you know, still... You know, I haven't seen him in a long time, but he would give me grief for my Hawaiian shirts. Every time, hey, nice shirt, pal. And we'd talk. And, you know, Sally had grown up with his mother as a Jehovah's Witness, and he had been brought door to door by her. That's where he learned how to be as glib and funny as he was. But Vinny would tell stories about growing up in Brooklyn, and he used to ride his bike to the various playgrounds to play, you know, pickup games when he was growing up, and he didn't want his bike to get stolen. So he used to put his bike under his arm and crawl up the cyclone fence and padlock it to the top of the fence and then climb back down and play all afternoon and then climb back up and unlock his bike and then bring it back down and ride it home. And Vinny bought a red, I want to say it's a Ferrari, I'm probably wrong, but he bought a red sports car, and he liked it so much he bought an identical one. And he was just open and honest and funny and real. And I used to look forward to Piston series because I could get to talk to Vinny.
In general, Charlie, in those days at the Herald and then at the National Sports Daily and the NBA at that point, in general, how did the players, coaches get along with writers? Was there as much, you know, like you said, the fellowship? You're not a homer, but there was, like, you're all part of something.
We all knew each other. I mean, it was, you know, the Celtics-Lakers days, we all knew we'd see each other in April. You know, and there was the traveling caravan of national NBA writers, and then those of us from, you know, Boston and L.A. and Detroit and Atlanta and Milwaukee to an extent, and Philadelphia a little bit at the beginning of the 80s. We all knew we'd have this rolling convention every spring. You know, we'd go and, you know, I'd be at home for, you know, obviously be at home for the Bostons. Then we'd all move to the, you know, the Airport Marriott in Los Angeles or some Marriott out in the suburbs in Detroit or the Omni in Atlanta. And, you know, it just became a regularly scheduled thing. And, you know, it, it, you know, we all, we all bonded together. And then, the NBA people obviously bonded together. And we would have these two little tribes that got along splendidly by and large, that would gather every spring or for the All-Star game, obviously, but then every spring for, seven games or five games or whatever. And it was something you came to rely on. It was like going to spring training. I mean, except you were going to a championship series. At the hospitality suite at the NBA Finals, everybody showed up. I mean, I remember, drinking a beer with Stephen Stills before I knew I didn't even recognize him until like 5 minutes into the conversation. I remember that really? David Stern came to the hospitality suite in LA one time. No, honest to God. And he sat down, and Jan Hubbard from Dallas and Fran Blindberry from Houston organized. They ordered a bunch of those little one-man Marriott pizzas that you could get, and they put a jar on the bar of the hospitality suite and inaugurated the first annual Hit the Commissioner with a Pizza for a Buck contest for NBA charities. And we started winging those pizzas into the wall over David Stern's head. And finally, David Stern looked around and said, "I'm getting the hell out of here," and laughed.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just the way things were.
I always felt at times like I was in a circus. I was traveling around with these people from different cities. We'd be at these events, and it was like we were part of this rollicking circus.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that's one, that was the, that was what I missed the most when I got out of daily sports writing, was not being part of being part of this, band of gypsy misfits who wandered from event to event and had the same concerns and had the same joys and the same, sorrows.